Hello and welcome. This is Cheryl Major with Coldwell Banker Real Estate here in Westford, and I want to welcome you to today's edition of Westford Area Real Estate. Now, today I have asked Tracy Callahan, who is the managing broker of the Westford Coldwell Banker Realty Office, to join us. And again, full disclosure, I am one of the realtors in Tracy's office, and I know Tracy's very much a data and statistics person, which I am not. So I thought it would be great to have her come here. She's got her finger on the pulse. I thought it would be really helpful to have some discussion about what's going on this fall, what might happen next year, and all those other good questions that we keep getting asked by buyers and sellers. So, welcome, Tracy. It's so good to have you here. I usually see you in the office, yeah. So this is a little weird.
This is fabulous, Cheryl. Thank you so much. I am so very excited that you asked me. And yes, I am a data geek.
I know.
I love the numbers. I love the stats. I love the stories that the data and the statistics tell.
Yeah.
And translating that to what we're actually seeing genuinely in the market.
Super. So tell us, what are you seeing right now?
Okay, no one would be surprised or shocked if I said it's a crazy real estate market right now. It has been, obviously because of COVID. Prior to COVID, it was a very strong market anyways. Mm. COVID has impacted it in a number of different ways, some positive, some negative. But right now, if I was to predict, we're in a better position, stronger position for a number of reasons, and I can get into that. In the real estate, it's stronger. It's not, the question I get asked most often is, when is the bubble going to burst? And when, you know, when this can't go on forever. Those are, you hear that, I hear that constantly. And it is a different situation now than it was historically in 07, 08, and 09 when we had that market crash, burst, bubble. There's a lot of factors that are different. But it is a strong real estate market. And one of the main reasons is that there is so much, folks have so much equity now in their homes. Back in what led us to the 08 demise was that the lending was so liberal and free, and there weren't many stop gaps put in there, and people got over their head. For instance, they could have had a 5-year or a 7-year ARM, and they were paying a low interest rate. That 5 years came up. All of a sudden, their interest rate went from 5.5 to 17.5, which took their mortgage payment from $1,800 a month to $3,800 a month, and they were no longer able to sustain that. We have a different situation now, because there was so much, people that have bought within the last 5 to 10 years have put much, much more cash down into their homes.
Yeah, we're not seeing zero down.
Absolutely not. No.
We saw a lot of those. I did a lot of those back then too. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And that's a good thing.
Oh, very good.
And a bad thing. It's tough for first-time home buyers. Yeah. It's a really tough market. One thing in particular that makes it very difficult is that buyer pool is competing with another new buyer pool that has kind of come up within the past couple of years, which is the downsizers. Mm. The people, the folks who've lived in the 4-bedroom, 2.5-bath, 2,500-foot colonial that now are not ready for a tiny condo or a retirement community. And so they're looking at a single-level ranch or a small cape, which is the classic starter home. So now you have two buyer pools, the first-time home buyers, who usually don't come with a lot of cash, and the, you know, I'll say baby boomers or the downsizers, who do come with a lot of cash because they're selling their primary residence. Now you've got two competing, and unfortunately, it's the first-time home buyer pool that loses.
Yeah, and we see it over and over again. And don't you think there's a lot of fatigue in the buyer pool right now? I mean, so many people, it's so hard because you fall in love with a house and you invest emotionally and then you lose it. And this happened to people time and time again. And I think people got tired toward the end of the summer and started to pull back a little bit.
Absolutely.
It's hard.
It's
hard
very
for
hard. I joke and laugh and say that I need to have a therapy couch in my office, because on Mondays or Tuesdays, you know, there'd be an open house, all the agents are out showing it. Their buyers absolutely love it. It's perfect. It's the fourth, fifth, sixth offer that they've put in for these folks. Offers are due on Monday. They find out Tuesday morning they didn't get it. In come the realtors, just dejected and feeling terrible and emotionally drained. And they said, my people aren't doing it anymore. My folks are going to, they're taking a break. They can't do this. And we did actually see, going back to the numbers, we did actually see this buyer fatigue happen around towards the end of August. Actually, July, August, he looked at the activity level. It was down. And I believe when you look at environmental factors, if you remember June, we had very, very wet, poor weather.
Yes.
So we didn't really get a summer.
Yeah.
So those buyers that were out lost that summer. So then if they've lost out on offers, they said, forget it. I'm not wasting my weekends in July and August looking for homes or putting offers in. I'm going to instead wait. I'll start again after Labor Day. And we did, in fact, see that in this past October. We had a record month for sales in our office and in the area, which correlates to the activity that would have started, you know, the very end of August or right around Labor Day.
Yeah. Are you seeing, do you think, as November came upon us, that people kind of decided to take another break because there's been so much excitement about the holidays and getting back to some semblance of normal, celebrating with family and friends, that there's a lot of I know a lot of focus on that. I've got kind of two thoughts going on, and the thing that made me go was I'm driving around town and I see Christmas decorations. It's not even Thanksgiving yet.
But I can't even get over it.
Yeah, but I think people are so excited about being able to cautiously and smartly get together that there might be a little bit of a pullback or a break over the holidays. Do you think it's going to go boom again after the holidays?
I do. Okay. Not just myself, but some of what I'm reading based on surveys from Realtor.com and some other statistics are about it being a record-breaking winter for sales.
Interesting.
So the buyers, yes, there's buyer fatigue. So there's those people that wanted to move up or wanted to buy this year. Maybe they were renting. We're seeing that number has gone down dramatically. Instead of 10 offers on a property, and a property might get 3 offers. But what that's telling us is that those buyers that are still out there are very serious buyers. So they didn't all go away. But the ones that didn't want to renew their lease in September, October, November, they signed their lease. They're off. They're on the side. But what the winter is showing and what the predictions are for, and by winter I mean, you know, the time from anywhere Thanksgiving to could be March or could be February. What it's showing and what's predicted based on seller sentiment is we know what we know now about seller home prices. We don't know what they are going to be like in the spring. So if you were serious about selling, you want a list. You want a list now because we know the serious buyers are out there. And yes, you might not get the 10 offers, but guess what? You need one, two to make it competitive.
Right. We always like
that. We like that.
We love
that second offer. One offer against the other. And I would put the seller agent hat on. Yeah. We don't know. Interest rates, you know, are predicted to still say, everyone says they're going up. I mean, up there historically low. So,
and we've been told that before, haven't we?
Yeah.
And they're a little volatile because they go up, they come down.
Correct.
They go up, they come down.
Correct, yep.
So.
Yeah, so I just had a session yesterday with some newer agents, and we were looking at understanding the market. And even if you're not a data-driven person, what story or talking points can you come out with to talk to your buyers or sellers? I know a lot of people are saying, should I wait now that it's almost Thanksgiving? Should I wait now and list before Christmas, or should I just wait till the first of the year? And what I say is, even if you listed the week after Thanksgiving, your house, you'll still be in your house because the majority of houses obviously have financing.
Yeah.
Financing takes anywhere from, you know, could be 30 days is a quick close, but it could be 45 days. You'll still be settled and the house will still be intact for the Christmas or Hanukkah, your celebrations first of the year. And then, you know, the moving will take place after that. So I think I advise everyone that yes, if you are ready, to sell. The other thing that we were discussing is the seller who wants to wait till spring because they love their rose bushes or their lawn will look so much better. And what I was saying is that the dollar difference between the curb appeal that their house might have if they wait till April versus the dollar difference that they may lose out on because if they listed now or February, there's less houses on the market. So they may be one or two on the market. Whereas if they miss that starting line and they are one of six or seven comparative properties, the dollar amounts that they're going to have between those offers are significant.
And that's such an important point, Tracy, because we've seen year after year after year that people want to wait until the crocuses are popping and the tulips are up and their house looks really pretty, and then they'll put their house on the market. And instead of being one of two or three listings to choose from, we will see, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's always a week, probably in April, where, boom, we see six, eight, 10 listings come on.
Yep.
Where we've been just struggling to find product for people, to find inventory for people. And I always counsel sellers, just don't do it.
Don't wait.
Don't wait.
You do not want to be in that burst. Yeah. You want to, you know what, using a race analogy, you want to jump the gun.
Yeah.
You want to say, now everyone says, what is that week or where is it? We don't know. Again, it's environmental factors.
Yep.
What kind of a winter did we have? Is there snow still on the ground? You know, what is the general feeling of people? Are they excited for something? Are they cautious because of something's going on? The other thing too is that when we look back and we do a lot of analysis of year over year data, because 2020 was the dumpster fire that it was, we don't use that data. And we're going back to, thank goodness, we're going back to 2019 and then, you know, adjusting for some prices. But I just want to throw a mind-blowing number out there for you.
Please.
So here's, I get my little math in here or my little statistics and numbers. Okay, so in October for the town of Westford, the median sales price, all the homes throughout the entire town, the median was $812,000.
Oh, my word.
$812,000. Now, that's not average, because if you remember the difference between average and median, here's a little statistics class for you. Average takes all of the numbers and divides it by the number of units that you have. Median takes, lines all the numbers up and takes the one that's in the dead middle. That's the median. And it's more important to use a median number than an average, because you could have the majority of the houses could all be in the $400,000 to $800,000 range, but you had a $3 million farm or $3 million or two or three million dollar properties, you're now skewing those numbers to the higher end. So in statistics you usually take the two outside numbers out. We're not getting, this could be a math class now. We're not doing that. But the story again, and the shocking factor, is $812,000 in Westford. Now, one other quick number just to set expectations or to set how different we are in the Northeast. We know that the Northeast is a different market.
Sure.
California is a very strong market, high market also. But nationally, in October, the median list price for the country was $380,000.
Wow.
So when they talk about affordability of, you know, New England, Metro Boston, they're not joking. There is a big difference.
Yeah, and Westford has changed dramatically. I know I've lived here for 30 years, and boy, it's a very different town in many ways.
Well, that's another factor. What we saw, you'll remember 15 to 20 years ago, there was the great wave outside of Boston.
Yes.
And it hit the 128-95 loop. The towns like Burlington, Billerica, Lexington, Waltham, Watertown, those prices started to go through the roof. Prior to COVID, we were seeing that. It was a little slow, but we've been seeing that in the last 4 or 5 years, that now the Beltway is 495. And people are fluxing out here, which has raised our prices.
Yeah.
Add on top of that a pandemic, which many employers have now gone partially remote, 2 days a week in a metro Boston area, So now people are saying, hold on, I can take my $1.2 million condo that I'm living in Waltham. I could buy a beautiful 4-acre home in Westford, and I only have to commute. So it's 45 minutes into the city. I only have to commute 2 days a week.
Exactly.
My quality of life from every other minute is so much more enhanced.
Yeah.
So we have seen an influx exacerbated by COVID.
Yeah, by COVID. And don't you think that the Westford schools certainly are a big draw? And
absolutely.
Don't you think, too, that people are much more aware of not being so crowded as a result of COVID and
yes.
It's kind of, you know, don't fence me in kind of mentality. And I think that's why people are, my sense is that that's one of the reasons why people are tending to move here.
Yeah.
And then they're supported by the school systems
exactly.
And the prices, you know, the value of the housing.
Absolutely.
Just
and
stays.
The feel of the town, the feel
oh,
of the
awesome.
Community really is something that it is a draw. You know, sometimes
yeah.
people underestimate that. They say, you know, it doesn't matter what town, blah, 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 blah. And they make cluster like 4 or 5 in a row. And, you know, as a real yeah. estate agent, you say, drive through those towns. Get a feel for those towns. Talk to people. Yep. It's not just what you can afford of the house and the location of what it is. What are the amenities and what is the feel of the
yeah.
town? Go to a town common on the farmer's market.
Right.
See if that connects with you.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you're going to narrow down what town you want to move to.
Yep, exactly. And also, I mean, just to give Westford Cat a plug, Westford Cat is one of the premier community access television
it's
stations.
A phenomenal resource.
It's phenomenal.
Absolutely.
It's absolutely phenomenal. Just going back to now being a good time to list, I wanted to mention to people, and a lot of people aren't aware of this, but a lot of corporations like to have new hires in place by the end of January.
Exactly. Our relocation department used to do a lot of work over this time of the year.
Yep. And people don't realize that. And also, I mean, if a lot of people are going to take their houses off the market, hey, good, you're going to be 1, 2, 3 instead of 1 of, you know, 10 or 12.
Mm-hmm.
So make hay while the sun shines, I say.
Absolutely.
You know? Go for it. So lots of changes.
Yes.
Speaking of changes, we have a big change coming up at Coldwell Banker.
We do.
Realty.
I am so excited. So a few years ago, about 4 or 5 years ago, we went through a national new branding. And with that, the company really wanted us to have consistency in what our brand represented.
Mm-hmm.
And that's we have the North Star, guiding you home is our motto. And we have been, while I absolutely love our big red barn,
oh, me too.
I love it. It's just not practical for our needs and for what we're doing moving forward. So what we've done is, and I'm so excited to announce it, we have secured a place right in Cornerstone Plaza.
I know.
High traffic area, beautiful location.
Super location.
And as we speak, it is being, the walls are up, it's being painted. I have a flow chart. I think this week the floors are going in. It is going to be spectacular. And I really hope to encourage the public and the community to come in and stop by. It'll be a place for resources. You know, we will have guides for buyers or sellers if they were in Cornerstone and they just wanted to pop in. And, you know, we're thinking of selling next year or the year after, which personally, when I was an agent, I wanted to have connection with those people.
Absolutely.
Because the more time you have to prepare for something, the easier, smoother of a transaction it will be.
And you can help, we can help advise them
Absolutely.
As to where to spend their money.
Yep.
It breaks my heart when I go in to list a house and they've done things that people are just going to undo because...
I know, the choices.
Whole other topic.
Exactly.
Yep.
What improvements to make mm-hmm. to get my house ready.
Exactly.
Chapter 2.
Exactly.
But yes, I'm so excited. Our
Fabulous.
Our date right now is, we should be in there December 17th.
Coming up fast.
It is coming up. Trust me, the boxes are building up in the office.
After,
because of the holidays, probably end of January or beginning of February, we would love to have a public open house.
Super.
Yeah. Invite folks to come in. We'll give them resources. They can, you know, meet our area realtors and just be a resource of information
yeah.
for folks.
And just, I mean, I think it's important that people understand that they don't have to be ready to buy or sell.
Not at all.
To ask the questions and just establish a relationship, because one of the most important things is to have a comfortable relationship with
Absolutely.
The broker that you're ultimately going to work with. And why not meet some different people and see who clicks with you?
Right. We are consultants.
Exactly.
And I really, truly believe that's the way we go about our business. And sometimes the public doesn't realize that. They think that they're reading online what I need to do and researching all of this stuff. And at the very last minute, they think they're going to list next week. So then they call an agent and a realtor. And there's so much value we can provide and guidance.
Yep.
And just like you said, what does my house need to sell? Now, getting a house ready to sell now is different than getting a house ready to sell 4 years ago. The things that you do, the investments, where you spend your time and your money, is much different. So even if you've been through the process a few years ago, it's better to check in now and get that updated guidance.
And I think we should have you back and have that as another segment.
I would love to. There's all sorts of, again, data. National Association of Home Remodelers puts out these annual reports about what you can recoup back. You know, if you spent $50,000 on a kitchen, you're not going to get $50,000 back.
Right.
But it has, based on your geographic area, what to expect and what improvements could cost. And,
that
we can definitely
cool.
talk about that.
That'd be cool. We'll have you back.
Yep.
Tracy, thank you so much for
thank
being
you, Cheryl.
Here.
This was so exciting.
This was such fun.
Yeah.
I love this. We'll have to do it again.
Absolutely.
All right. I want to thank everybody for joining us on Westford Area Real Estate, the podcast. This is Cheryl Major signing off for now, and we'll talk to you again soon. Bye-bye.